Okay, I think I've been a bit of a tease on Facebook at least. I put up this photograph with a teaser about another new Gazelle. I should have put a note on saying library photograph. This image is more aspiration than reality. However, here we are. That image is more aspiration than reality. Let's get back to reality and a late night dog walk. Welcome to dog walking, Philosopedium style. It's evening. It's only about 6 or something. And I'm out with Tigger. I went with Tigger to pick up a small item that was being thrown out by someone locally, made of tubular steel on different nice curbs. I thought, I'll have that. Some baby thing, and knocked on the door, started talking to the chap, and I saw something in the back of the garage. Now, what you're supposed to do in these circumstances, of course, is something along the lines of, come on Tigger, Tigger that side, good boy. Something along the lines of, do you want to sell that knackered old bike over there? That's how the experts do it. Of course, expert negotiator me, I adopted a different tactic of, oh wow, a Gazelle. I love Gazelles, they're my brand, I collect them. Is it for sale by any chance? So as for price, well, fortunately, my expert negotiating technique didn't work, and the chap gave me the bike. So the price was definitely right, and I'll tell you what it is when we get it back. Obviously it's a Gazelle, obviously it's not an ancient one, but it's not a modern one. But there is a personal relevance to me and my bicycling life and my life with Gazelles. So I'll tell you all about that when we get it back to the workshop. I'll tell you what it is, show you its features, then I'll tell you why it's got a personal significance to me, and we'll discuss what I'm going to do with it. And so here we are. Back in the workshop. Not exactly like that photograph, is it? But it's the same model. This is a little bit later. Now, what we have is a, I would guess, mid-90s, late 90s even, Gazelle Special, with a double L, you see. And datable loosely by its colour scheme, this two green fade, and they had one other colour scheme which was two blues, and I think that was all these models were offered in. And it's three speed with drum brakes. It's regarded in Dutch parlance as a sports or touring bike, because of course their roadster would just have a single speed with a coaster brake in the back and no front brake. This has what they call hand brakes. Now you'll notice it's the Gazelle copy of a Sturmey Archer. For some reason Gazelle had this quirk of putting them on the right hand side. A Sturmey Archer brake is usually on the left hand side, and Gazelle used their own back plate, and the hub is interchangeable, in fact, with Sturmey Archer. It's so much of a copy. Gazelle used their own back plate with the arm on the opposite side so that it could be mounted, or has to be mounted, on the right hand side. I don't know whether that's something to do with the rod operation mechanism or what, but it's a way of telling a Gazelle, certainly if it's got its original front wheel, and it will have the mounting bracket or a tab on the inside of the right hand fork, not the left hand. That's a sign of a Gazelle. And rod operated drum brakes, both ends, and they have another feature which Gazelle were very proud of. Watch what happens when I pull this rod. You see they both move? They're interlinked, so they operate together. And you see the front one is on a... It's all a bit closely adjusted, it's almost touching, so there's not much movement in it. Front one is on a rocker there. And they're interlinked inside here, where you'd normally have nothing there. Let me just scooch over to another bike here that just there has nothing in between the two rods. The Gazelle has this little box here, and in there is the linkage between the two bars, levers. Now then, what's the purpose of that? Quite simply, it's set up, or it should be set up by the factory, so that the rear brake engages very slightly before the front brake. And that's an anti-skid measure. So you've always got correct application of both brakes together, even when riding one-handed. So you've got full braking and full control when you're making hand signals or riding with an umbrella. So yes, Gazelle made a bike to facilitate riding with an umbrella. I'll just let that sink in for a second. This is Dutch cycling, you see. To actually make a bike for people who cycle with an umbrella. Now this, the sports frame, it's less heavy and less heavily built than the big roadsters, but it still has the relaxed angles, about a 68 degree parallel, something like that. I'm looking here as though they might not be parallel, but I think that's just because I'm looking at the screen, not the bike. A lighter version of the carrier. It hasn't got the big drop down stand on the back that the roadsters have. Gazelle's characteristic built-in rear light. That mudguard stay should be further down. We'll go into that in a minute. Again, datable by the chain case. That's a 90s chain case, I'd say, and the way that the cotterless square taper crank is integrated into it, like that as well. And cover over the Sturmey Archer gear mechanism. And it has the horrible Brompton style three-speed shifter. It would have had an oval headlight on there as well, a plasticky item, which I'm kind of glad has gone. And the ornate Leaping Gazelle mascot on the mudguard has given way to, again, plastic. The rims are the usual Van Schothorst stainless brass spoke nipples, etc., etc. Stainless steel spokes, all high quality. And it was a few notches up the range. It was a mid-range bike. And now we'll go on to why I like it, why I've got a particular attraction to this bicycle. Spool back to the 90s, and in York, the big rally dealer, Russell's, had closed down, and there wasn't really any availability of classic three-speed bikes that were really popular among the people of York. And a bit like Oxford and Cambridge, that's the kind of bikes that were favoured by a practically minded transport cyclist customer base. A car parts accessory shop manager called Andy saw this, and so he changed the car parts shop into a bicycle shop and called it Cycle Heaven. And his intention was to cater for the real world cyclist. And he became the first UK importer, I think, for Gazelle, more or less unheard of in the UK. I'd seen them around in the Netherlands. I didn't realise that they were the creme de la creme. They were just another Dutch bike brand as far as I was concerned. I hadn't taken much notice. And of course, most of the ones I'd seen in Amsterdam were complete sheds anyway. So, going back to York, to the opening of Cycle Heaven, not long after it opened, I went along there for my first visit. I remember it distinctly. I came away with a pair of cork handlebar grips for my first Rally Superb, big 28-inch wheeler. And in the window was this exact bike, a green Special. In this size, I think, 60 centimetres, the most popular size. Exactly like this. And very unfashionable at the time. It had information boards attached to it in various places, showing the points and the features. Things like stainless steel rims with brass spoke nipples and outlining the anti-skid dual operation brakes, the weatherproof drum brakes, and the chain case, of course, all the features of the bike, explaining why the relaxed frame angles were a good idea, and just going into each feature on the bike, the way it's built so durably, the paint process, the rust proofing. Not a very fashionable way to describe a bike, but it appealed to the market, and they really took off, to the extent that they became a bit of a fixture in York, the Gazelles, and Cycle Heaven did really well and continues to do really well. It's a fantastic bike shop and it gives a wonderful service to the people of York. So shout out to Cycle Heaven and anyone who knows Cycle Heaven. I'm glad they're still thriving. Back to its early days though, I remember there was a few years after that, there was an article in one of the Sunday supplements that referred to the Gazelle Ladies of York, and it painted a picture of these middle-class ladies of a certain age gliding along by the riverside on their gazelles with their colourful scarves floating in the wind. Yeah, and it's true, there were many of them. I have to confess I dated a few of them. But that is definitely a digression. So, this green Gazelle Special really had an effect on me. It changed the course of my cycling life, I'd say. I fell in love with that bike. I thought I wanted one desperately. After a while, I did buy a Gazelle. And I bought an Impala, which is more or less this bike, but with cable brakes. I could only get it in the blue fade rather than the green. And those who know me know I like green bikes. But this was blue, the only one available, so I got this blue one. Had it for many years, and I'll put a picture up in the middle, maybe a couple of pictures, whatever I can dig off Flickr on my phone, of my Impala. I changed the Impala, I think it was about 8 years, 8-10 years. I changed the Impala for an altogether more modern new Gazelle, an Orange City Light, a very fancy schmancy thing. Picture if I can find a picture. Very nice, but I didn't take to it. I really didn't take to it. So after a couple of years, I changed that for my Koga Miata that I still have now, the blue one that you've seen quite a lot on this channel. So that was my initiation into Gazelles, and of course now I have nine now. This is number nine, so I have four on the active fleet and four down in the storage lockups, and this one. And Gazelle have become my other brand to rally. In fact, I have four brands because I also have Pedersen and Rivendell, but they're more aspirational. Yeah, in the real world, it's mostly Gazelle and rally. And I have to say that Gazelle just about trumps rally. I have rallies and I have rally memorabilia because I'm in England and that's, you know, you find the stuff. But I've also got Gazelle bits and bobs as well. Maybe it's because Gazelle are still made in the same factory and are still making everything themselves, well, making the, you know, the bicycle, rather than just sticking labels on Vietnamese and Chinese bikes. I feel more attached to Gazelle, I think, nowadays. So, that's what the bike is. That's my personal connection to it. So what am I going to do? Well, I still have this business to sort out on the Superb. I've still got these bikes with all of their jobs written on them to work through. I did mention last week that I was thinking of having a little break and doing a project and then carrying on with that lot. I think this is the project. I was going to bring the Crown Star 531 up and do that. This has kind of fallen into my lap. It's a fairly easy project. The front brake is dragging and you can see the back plate's a mess. I think I'll change the back plate. I've got plenty of them. Tyres, that's more of a back tyre than a front really. The tube's popped on that one. Back tyre's holding air. I think that's a Schwalb. I think that's a Marathon. I'll see how it is. I might put that on the front and put this slightly more traction oriented tyre on the back. I have other pairs. I have a pair of Schwalb Marathons, a pair of Continentals, a pair of Rabinas, all in the same black with reflective line. On a green bike, I could put cream tyres, like the earlier Special models. I didn't mention Special is a name that Gazelle have had on bikes since, I think, the 20s. A bit like Superb, I suppose. I could make it like an earlier model and put cream tyres on. But this is going to be more of a bike for using. More of a daily. So I think I'll go for something more practical. Plus, putting original looking tyres on, it makes it more like the Gazelle I first fell in love with, and I think maybe that's what I'm going to recreate. I have a brown Brooks B67 I can put on there. The brown will go nice with the green. I have brown leather grips that I can fit as well. They'll look nice, but then are they going away from that original Gazelle again? And this is a nice little touch, like they put extra grips on the brake rods. Now that's black, so should I maybe leave black grips on? Should I put some nicer leather black grips on? I'll think about it. I'll think about whether to faithfully recreate the original Gazelle that I fell in love with, or whether to just change the soft parts, because they can always be changed back. Tyres, yeah, I'll stay black. Saddle and grips, I don't know, they might go brown leather. Now, it needs, as I say, it needs a good service. This front hub is looking quite ropey, actually. I might build another front wheel around another Gazelle hub, or even a Sturmey Archer hub shell. I'll see to that. I even have other wheels. I have a wheel with a hub dynamo in, as well as the brake. This one has an AXA dynamo with the large rubber roller, plastic roller, so it's not so noisy. Check whether that works. Of course it needs a headlamp. I have a selection of headlamps, that's not a problem. Mudguard stays are completely gone on the front. Again, not a problem. I have a box full of new old stock mudguard stays of the correct type, and they're all black or silver, but I can spray them. This is just about a fade from Rover British Racing Green down to Ford Forest Green. I have some Ford Forest Green, so I can paint some mudguard stays in that colour. Mercifully, the chain case is intact, so I can keep the original chain case. Again, I have three boxes full of new old stock chain cases. But you can guarantee I probably wouldn't find one that fitted properly. A bit of rust on there, no problem. Again, lots of stainless in the wheel department, so we don't have any rust problems there. Rear hub, I'll give a service as well. I'll probably put new gear cables on as a matter of course, and probably new toggle chain indicator rod inside there. Yeah, the rear mudguard stay is just as knackered as the front one, so that'll be replaced as well. It goes on down here. There's a Gazelle badge to cover the mounting points. The bottom of the front mudguard is ropey, but I have some original Gazelle mud flaps which attach to here, the great big spatboard mud flaps. So I think I'm going to put one of those on and tidy up that horrible edge, cut it off above the rust, and then hide it with one of the big Gazelle mud flaps. Nice shortcut. And it even has Gazelle branding on the mud flap, so it's visibly the correct thing. Unfortunately we've lost the nice little Gazelle on top of there. Let's see if I've got one. The seat post may be stuck. If it's stuck, I'll do my best to free it off, because it's a mess, rather than just use it anyway. It's about my height, but of course it'll be getting a Brooks on. I'm not going to leave this saddle on. Even if I decide to stay black, I'll put a black Brooks on. I have one. I will put an LED in here. This is the dynamo powered rear light. That'll get an LED in it. And you've got the Gazelle branded reflector on there. The coat guards, nothing I can do about that. Obviously they need to be chucked. I have a stock of such items. I just need to go through and see if there are any three different places, how organized, see if there are any that fit and are suitable, that are 28 inch and in a brown. They won't be that exact shape, so I'll see what happens regarding fitting that. The lock has been broken, no problem. Ta-da! Sat on the workbench. That was on the workbench as I wheeled the bike in. That was already on there. Kismet, eh? Almost the same. Oh, it is. AXA SL7. Yeah, it is. Exactly. So it just hasn't got that piece of plastic with DPC on it. Let's have a look. Yeah. If that's not serendipity, I don't know what is. Paint wise, it's looking shabby. I think a good buff first and several coats of clear, some little dabs of touch up here and there. Again, I've got Ford Forest Green, I've got Volkswagen Dragon Green, or Rover British Racing Green, either of those, whichever's best. So I don't even have to buy any new paint for it. It can be a zero cost refurb on a zero cost bicycle. There is such, well, there may not be such a thing as a free lunch, but there is such a thing as a free Gazelle. What's the rear mudguard like at the bottom? I didn't have a look. That's not bad. I'll repaint that. So the white part will be repainted. I didn't want to replace the mudguard because they all have their own dealer sticker on, you see? And all my Dutch bikes have these little dealer stickers, and I think it's rather nice to keep them. It just adds some character to the bike, and shows the history of the bike, shows it's a genuine Dutch one. Sorry about my hands here, I'm just fiddling about with stuff. Right. Yeah, a Cycle Heaven sticker would have been the ultimate, of course. Having written down the frame number of the original and find that this is the same bike, that would have been kismet. But that, I'm very happy. I'm going to enjoy my little time machine. That's what it is, really. As a Dave the Bard song says, our time machine is our history. Yeah. It's a bit of a time machine for me, personally. Back to my first contact with Gazelles. And I was just getting back into cycling from the old car world. I sort of went cold turkey on old cars, and bikes became the new obsession. And I was into all the interesting, unusual stuff, the recumbents and the load carriers, the cargo bikes, the classics, of course, the vintage as well. And so this steered me in the direction of Dutch city bikes. Had I not seen this bike in the showroom, I might not have developed that particular interest in this big world of cycling. So there we are. This is going to be a quick project. I'm going to film it, but it's not going to be spread over four videos like a lot of them. I'll just pare it right down. I might not even stand there waffling. I might just put the camera on the tripod and get on with it, and you can watch scenes of me doing it, rather than me stand there and talk for hours through everything. Okay, there we go. A mid-90s Gazelle Special. Now, just before any of the bike geeks ask me, I've just been right round this Sturmey Archer hub, and it has no markings and therefore no date. So I can't find out the date that way. And you can't do it with serial numbers on these. So I'm going to put it as mid to late 90s. I first saw the bike, I think, about 97. I might look back through Cycle Heaven's history and see if I can get a more precise date of when I saw that one. And really, I'll give this one the same date as that. And one last thing. We talked about serendipity tonight. Guess what I was wearing? Yep. There's something in the air.